Hello everybody, here we are back in my workshop. Slightly different today, of course. We're doing much bigger projects. We're just stepping away from the Christmas projects for now, and we're going to look at a few more tutorial type projects, I think. We've got the lovely Mrs. Way behind the camera today. Vicky's there. The boys are both busy, and so she's going to be asking me your questions as much as she can. There is an element of this that's going to be going dark, and the reason I say that, Vicky, I want right out the way of what's happening, because you can see the size of pieces we've got going on the lathe today. Now, this is just there as an example. I'm not going to waste your time by turning through it. We'll have a little bit of a dab. We're just making a few cuts. But I've got several stages. Vicky, just pan down to the floor. Several stages of what we're doing. So if you haven't had a look at my very enthusiastic Daily Deal video that went on today, the Daily Deal at the moment is the woodcut bowl saver. And I thought, well, we were tasks as tutors to do videos on the various Daily Deals that are coming out every day. So myself, Ben, Jason, Craig, we've all done our own section of Daily Deals. Bowl saver for me. Yesterday it was the JSP visor. So I'm going to wear two today. I'm going to use both of those Daily Deals. I thought, why not? Certainly the bowl saver, and I'll show you that one in a minute, is a cracker of a deal. It's £100 off. So it's basically we're £269, I think, instead of £369. It's a ridiculous deal. So that's the cracker one. And the £20 off the JSP, again, I use this one all the time. I would always, anyway, wear this over just my specs when I'm dealing with timber this size. Obvious reasons. Safety first. If something went wrong here, then there's a big lump of wood coming off. So I want to protect my head, as well as just my eyes, of course. I've got teeth, and I've got nose, I've got chin that I want to worry about. And Mrs. Wade needs to worry about, you know. So we've got to think about all those things. So my visor is going to be there as well. Now, I'm going to show you the woodcut bowl saver in a minute. We're going to do a nest of bowls, or probably just take one out, because, again, time is the issue. If you follow me on Instagram at all, Colwyn Way Woodturning, you'll see the story of this ash tree. So I went and got another carload again with Charlie on Sunday, it was. I had a carload the week before, fortnight before, I think, with the rest of the family. There's some rough turn bowls down there already. And so what I picked up on Sunday with Charlie was this stuff directly beneath my lathe at the moment. This is this one that's on the lathe I've left raw, just to show you how we set that up. These two here, these big bowls here, I've done those this morning, so they're ready to start coring. And I just wanted to show you different stages, really, of what we're doing. So, let's have a look. First of all, this piece that's on the lathe. Those two down there were the same size as this one that's on the lathe at the moment. And I just wanted to go through it, because it's easy to just rush into things like this and have an accident. This is big bits of timber now. So there's lots of things I wanted to go over. Firstly, when we mount this on the lathe, so in the field, when I'm cutting this timber with a chainsaw, I do as much work as possible. Take a couple of circle boards. So this is my circle board, so 14, 15 and a 16-inch. 16 is the maximum I can get on my lathe over the bed without swiveling or without putting my sub base on, which will give me 3 foot. But without doing that, that's 16-inch. So I'm going to stick to that. So these particular ones are 14s. Take those out in the field, cut them as roughly the shape with the chainsaw first. That saves you huge amounts of work, because trying to cut this sort of stuff on the bandsaw is really, really difficult. One thing I will say, in terms of cutting on the bandsaw, let me get this lump in. So there's a difficult bit to cut on the bandsaw. I've done most of the work on with the chainsaw. However, I can't rest that on the bed and cut around, because it'll be wobbling all over the place. So what I do instead is cut it up the straightway with a flat on the bed of the bandsaw, and use one of my discs. Just pop a little nail in there, and then don't actually cut the disc, just avoid it. Get a 2 or 3 mil away with the bandsaw blade, and you can cut around that disc, and that pops you out a nice little round blank, even though you've got a full bark on one side. So you can put your faceplate on there if you want to, and then you can start turning. And that's going to be a lovely little bowl, because all of this tree, if you follow the story of this tree, is rippled like crazy. Absolutely incredible stuff. So just a nice little tip there. Big faceplate on the back of this one. as many screws as I can get in, and I'm around about an inch and a half in depth there. We're gonna probably out of this piece do about three bowls, so you know, I'm not too worried about the depth of screw there. Like I say, a good inch and a half is perfect. And then we're gonna use the tailstock. And in terms of using the tailstock, I'm using, this is one of the Pro Drives, so something with a big center in it. So I think maybe you wanna come on over a little bit closer now. But anything like that, either that, the Evolution center we're looking at here, Vic. Yeah. So Pro Drive, or we're looking at an Evolution center here, something with more than just a center point. We want these, either these serrations around here or a big ring around it, that sort of thing. Okay, so something big. The other thing, I'm gonna size feet for the bowl. We're not messing around now when it comes to sizing feet for these bowls. We're gonna use the, what we call the optimum size of the chuck. That means where it's at its perfect circle. With the Axminster chuck, that's basically 6 mil gap between the jaws here. Okay, 6 mil gap here. That's really quite important, because that's where you've got most, or where you've got complete physical contact. If you're wider than that, you'll only have the two corners touching. If you go smaller than that, you'll only have the center touching. So you do, for this sort of size work, you need to be bang on, get that optimum size. And also, I'm using a fairly lumpy jaw as well. We're using a big jaw, a gripper jaw in that case. I'll show you that in a second. I'll show you the foot that we've created on them already, but let me just show you how we start here. This lathe of mine, this is a 406, this is a 2 horsepower lathe. This is a 2 horsepower lathe now, so it's not a small lathe, but on the other hand, it's not massive either. There is much bigger lathes out there. 2 horsepower lathe, but you would still need to nurse the machine. And we get a lot of issues about how, well, a lot of questions about how fast to turn, that sort of thing. There's a couple of things going on here. First of all, I'm going to start as slow as the lathe will allow me. In my case, it's zero. It's going to actually kick in at 50 when I start dialing up. And then I'm just going to test. I'm going to see how quick I can go within reason. There will be a limit, and every bowl will be completely different, because you'll get wobble if you go too fast. Maybe you could get an extra couple of hundred revs out of one bowl more than another, because there's different balance points on all of these bowls, you see, because they're all gnarly, they're not a uniform shape. The other thing, I've gone down my pulley setting on the lathe. So this particular machine has two pulley settings, a high range and a low range. And that's just like gears on a bicycle or gears on a car. If you keep your lathe in the same range all of your life, that's basically driving around town in fifth gear, or going up the motorway in first gear. It's not doing the car any good. This is the same. So that's where you would use your different pulley settings. I need maximum power, but low speed. So I go down to my low range on the lathe. It saves the lathe a huge amount, and it will stop the lathe from stopping continuously. Because when you're at high range, it's delivering you lots of speed, not that much power. Okay, so that's the reason we would swap between one pulley set and another. So I better stop talking, we better start turning, otherwise we're not going to have time to finish. Vic, before I go dark, do you want to ask any questions? Are there any at this stage?
I haven't seen any yet, no.
No, grand.
Did you want to show the back or not?
No, we're all good. Okay. Faceplate, well, come on, have a quick look then.
I was going to say.
Faceplate is a faceplate, but all faceplates made equal, I don't know.
That's what the back looks
like. Big old faceplate, 6-inch one there, some deep screws in. Okay. And also thick in, you know, they're not thin, skinny little screws. They're not cheap screws. These are a Torx screw, our own screw, a good quality one. So you'll find a cheaper screw, if you screw it in, won't shear off when you put it in. It'll shear off when you go and take it out. And then you're in a world of bother. Trying to get those out is a real nightmare. So decent quality wood screw for definitely. Now, I'm not going to do... or complete this right to you know, the outside shape. I want to just do a little bit of turning for you, so just to prove that, yeah, it can, that you can do this sort of size bowl on this sort of size lathe. That's what it's for.
Question, yeah. With the taper on the signature skews, can you sharpen? Oh, I missed it. Can you sharpen them on a pro edge sharpening system?
Yes.
Yes.
That's pro right. edge, ultimate edge, Tormek. They'll all work the same as long as it fit in the jig. Just because it's a taper, it doesn't mean to say it doesn't hold any well. The only thing you can't do is use Tormek or pro edge settings because of the taper. So I would blacken the back and line the cutting edge to 90 degrees to your machine and sharpen by eye. That's the best way on that one.
All right.
Right, I'm going to crack on.
So
I'm just going to nibble away. We're going to do a little bit of turning and then we're going to stop and put the pre-prepared blank on and we'll start doing some coring for you, okay? So here goes. All I'm doing, look, I've got, I'm going to set the tool rest up. We're going to start the lathe speed at low. I'm using a half inch bowl gouge. So quite a big bowl gouge. And just do a little bit of nibbling away for you just to see, because it's a bit of a violent act, this one. You've got to have your breakfast in the morning to take on a bit of this. And if you're doing a day's worth, you'll know all about it in the evening. So you'll notice the tarp as well. The tarp means rough turning. That's wet turning, because I don't want all the shavings filling up my shelves up there. Okay. If you weren't here, the tarp would be completely surrounding what's going on, because I've got a plane of thicknesser over there with a lovely steel bed. And I don't want that getting rusty. The bandsaw I used this morning has now got a load of camellia oil on it. This has been laden with camellia oil already and will be washed clean down with camellia oil at the end as well.
What's the best tool to use for end grain?
Depends what the project is, if I'm honest. So tell me, just do me a question for Lily. Lily, can you keep that question to one side? I'll answer it tomorrow. But be specific on what project. So, because if it's boxes, it'll be one tool. If it's bowl turning or hollow forms, it'll be another. All right? So yeah, be a bit more specific on that one. And I'll answer it directly for you tomorrow. Right, I'm going to start turning. So I've got to remember to take this off. We've got the remote here, so I'm going to bring that close to me. I don't want to be reaching over a big lump of timber to control the speed, or if something goes wrong, to try and turn it off. I want this where I'm safe. So, all right, so over my side. There we are. Let me just bring you a little bit closer. I want Vicky to stay out the way. There we are. Well, I'm only going to do about 5-10 minutes of this. I'm only going to do about 5 or 10 minutes of this. Thank you.
I'll just do a little bit more for you, just adjust the saw rest first though.
Just do a little bit more for you, I'm just adjusting the tool rest. So just turn the speed up a little bit there. Look and see what we're dealing with. I've also got my calipers set ready to test diameter. Just a whisker off of that and that'll be okay. You know, I think we're nearly there. We've got enough time. We've finished preparing the outside of this one. You can already start to see ripple, and this is in a gnarly old rough turn piece. When that's finished, that's going to be absolutely stunning. We're going to talk about sort of the pith, the centre pith of the tree as well. It's quite important to talk about that because we certainly don't want to have that left in there.
Nearly there. I think I'm going to just shape it slightly differently. A little bit more speed now.
There we are, that's that bowl goes pretty much dull. we're dealing with a cadmium layer, and cadmium layer can cause us all sorts of problems. So I'm just going to finish off by taking a little bit more off of that, tidying this area up, and then we'll reverse it and get it on the lathe ready for coring. One thing I'll say, when you put this on, you've come from the field, you've got your corners off, you've even done a bit of work on the bandsaw, you think it's small enough, and you've put it on the lathe. Sometimes you can just get an annoying corner. So I tend to have, when I'm rough turning bowls, the Arbitech next to me, just an Arbitech blade. This is the Pro blade in here, but any of the Arbitech range, you know, you can put that on and just nibble away a couple of corners, lock your lathe up, nibble away the corners, and it just helps get these things mounted on the lathe. It's just a handy tool to have close. Okay, so let's get my helmet back on. We'll take a little bit more off of that and then reverse it. Okay, Vic, do you want to get back on the camera? Just ask some questions if there are any. We're going to calm things down a little bit now. Create a hole for me to work in as well with the shaver. Big old bowl, that one. Like I say, the maximum diameter for bowls are over the bed on this machine is 16 inch, which is still a big bowl. And I find certainly if it's salad bowls, pretty much where I want to be. Just take that one off. We'll unscrew the faceplate, we'll get the chuck on, and then we're going to mount ready for coring. I would prepare the workshop if you're going to do this, because everything gets covered. All my tools on the back bench here, they're nice and full with shavings. I'll put my tape on top of the screw box just to protect them a little bit. Right, so we're going to use big gripper jaws. This particular jaw, what we call the Dove Type A jaw. They've got a big dovetail on the outside, but a nice strong gripping section on the inside. I'm going to bring the bowl up. Screw that front surface up. Again, I'm going to have the tailstock. Tailstock as much as possible. You know, why not? We may as well use it. It's another safety feature or safety precaution we can take. So if we can take it, let's do it. There we are. I just want to screw that face up. Visor. Vic, do you want to just stand back for a minute?
faster now.
So there's a nice clean face there now. We're ready to start coring. One thing I wanted to show you, we're talking of, or we, I spoke about the centre of the tree. I made sure that that's gone. I'm going to show you this blank down on the floor a moment. So this one here, there's the heart of the tree. Okay, that has to go. So the top of my bowl here is going to be there. So that top inch is going to be sacrificed to get rid of that. Otherwise, you're going to have cracks radiating out from there as this bowl dries. It will never dry in one piece. So it's quite important you get rid of those. Get rid of that centipede. Think about that when you're chainsawing. Pop that to one side. Right. So we need to create a hole point. I'm going to use a good big set of jaws, set of grippers. So I need to set a chuck up with those in. We're going to make, give us the ability to be able to turn the bowl over fairly quick. So just on the chuck there a bit, all right. So we're going to take out those jaws. That chuck that I just started undoing is my brand new one, so it has my safety, little safety feature, which I'm keen to keep in there. So basically that one's got a way of retaining the jaws. You can't wind them all the way without taking a little screw out underneath. And that's just to stop you unwinding it too far. Personally, I take it out because I know my chuck. If you're just starting, it's worth keeping that little safety feature in. I'm purposely keeping it in on that chuck. I want one that has it just so I can show people. So that's my, this is a set of gripper jaws, what they call gripper jaw type H. Okay, I'm closing it to its optimum size. And then I'm going to set my dividers. And we're going to, you only have to do this once on when you're coring one nest of bowls. And then I'm just going to do a recess that we can hold. So there we are. That's our whole point. We're sized to the Dove H's, or the Type H. We're going to start setting up our bowl pourer now. So I'm going to work on about an inch and a quarter, about 30 mil. Let's get a better pencil. About 30 mil for each bowl.
Here you go.
So about 30 mil. So one there, pop another there. And if we were greedy, we could get another one, but I'm not. I'm just going to leave it. We'll have one, two, three. All right, your most important bowl is your outside one, the big one. That's where you're going to make more money, or be a little bit more spectacular. Okay, so tool rest out of the way. We're going to work on the first one. That's going to core out these two. I'll then reverse onto the H drawers, create the back hold point again, and repeat the process. So let's get our bowl saver in. We've got two blades on the bowl saver. So as this is a big lumpy bowl, we need the big one. Anything under sort of 8 inches, you go down to the small blade. Okay, at the moment that's the dead blade, not using it. So tool tailstock in. I've set the collar on this one. I've got a collar underneath here that's on the tool post, so I set to centre every single time. Wind that back. It's a fairly violent act, this one. I would always wear ear protectors when I'm doing it. Not so much when we're going down the front face, but when we veer across the bottom, you're actually cutting end grain in two positions there, so it gets a little bit noisy at that point. And we need to nurse the lathe. You can quite easily stop any lathe here. Your bowl saver comes with two templates, paper templates. I've made them into plywood templates, but they come with paper templates. Big blade, small blade. Basically what we're going to do, you rest that on the back of the bowl back here, and that to center point. That's where you want your first one. So that's going to give you an idea. At the moment, I'm maximum. So I can go as close as I want with this one. This because it's a 6-inch deep bowl. If it was only a 3-inch, I'd bring that back and we'd have to have the bolt. This is the center bolt mark, back a little bit further and so on. As you go down through the bowls, you'll have to sort of creep it back a little bit more. That stays nice and close to the support, but that dictated where this will end. So I'm right the way back there, so I can come right up to the front face. Line the cutter up with where I want to start. So there, as close as I can physically get. Let's bring that back a little bit further. There we are, as close as I can physically get. And this one. Pop that in the Morse taper. The question was asked, what size motor do you need? Really, I think, you know, this is a two horsepower motor on this one. I wouldn't go any lower. I can stop this lathe quite easily if I'm aggressive with the cut. So I'm locking up. This is adjustable. So this slides back and forward to suit where we're going to position the actual bowl saver itself. We're ready. Okay, I'm going to start nice and slow. Let's get my tools out of the way. I'm going to put my ear protectors on. Vicky's going to step back.
Is this angle good?
I think that angle's pretty good. I think everyone can see. Yeah, that's a pretty good angle. Okay, so here goes. we're getting there. Just going to make one slight adjustment. Just going to alleviate some of that stress. Got it. Back on again. And up the speed now, because we're going down to a smaller diameter. Have a test just to see how close I am. Still got a little bit to go yet, but we're getting close to that now. I need Vicky, big screwdriver, big yellow handled screwdriver. I think it's either on the bench there or in the top drawer, and I can take the ear defenders off now. We're going to pop that one out. Bring that back out of the way. So now that bowl is ready to reverse back onto the H jaws, create the foot. We might have time to do this actually, and prep up for your next one. So let me just pop that on the floor for a minute. I'm just going to tidy that up, take my tool, my tailstock out of the way, and well, nothing more perfect than the robust tool rest. Any questions there, Vic? Well, we got chance.
No, can't see any.
So to go with, again, let's go with our half inch bowl gouge now. Let's go with a sharp one.
Yeah,
through here. Pop on your goggles. You're going to get covered in shavings. Now Vicky's going to stand back again and out of the line of fire. Make sure we're nice and tight. All I want to do here, I mean, it's pretty even, that wall thickness, but just take a little bit out of this section and we're done. Just tidy up, really. So that's our big bowl, that's our main money maker, that one.
Colin, is there any reason not to do the smaller bowl first? That's from Clive.
Is there any reason not to do the smaller bowl first? It's a thickness thing. You know, the most expensive one, that, like I say, the money maker is this baby here. I want to make sure that's all sorted. I don't want to end up, you know, starting on the middle with the smallest one, working our way up and suddenly find, oh, actually, I don't have enough wall thickness on the bottom of the bowl. So it's just retaining this one, making sure that's the baby. There, that one's ready. That's going to take about 6 to 8 months to dry now, and then we can finish it off, and that's a nice big salad bowl. Let's just prep up the other one, ready to start pouring. We're getting there on this one then. Just quickly pop in the other set of drawers. One of those things that I don't like doing normally is a demo, because on a demo you've got lots of people around, and if anything goes wrong, because these are big lumps of timber, there's a potential for hurting people. So when it's a remote demo, or like this, and there's no one around, Vicky gets right out of the way, you know, I'm the other side of the bowl, I'm taking all the precautions I can. It's a safer environment, is what I'm trying to say.
Can you go through the pool cuts, please? Often get a catch. That's from Will.
Pool cuts, no problem. We'll do that here. So we're going to just pop that on the H jaws. You saw me size that foot. So now we're going to make another foot here. I'll go back to the set that we, or the size that we used on the other bowl. And we'll go with the same gouge. So first of all, a pool cut, so there's no bevel rubbing on a pool cut, but what you've got to be careful of, if you have the flute facing upright, you think about how your cutting edge is presented to the timber. It's basically a knife edge pointing upwards, so there's nothing for it to do apart from dig in. So you've got to turn it over, and if you're unsure, turn it right the way over to sort of 9 o'clock, and then start playing. The further up you position that flute, the more aggressive the cut becomes, or the more timber it'll take away. So that's probably the reason. The other thing is, don't bring your handle too far around when you're doing a bowl, because then you'll have all of that bottom edge in contact with the timber, and it doesn't like it. So about 45 degrees to the timber. About right. So foot first. Let's just see size-wise where we are. A little bit small there, so I'm going to increase the size down a little bit further. So there, we've got a bit of a taper going on. Let's make it a bit deeper. Now There we are. We are now ready to remount, set the core back up again.
Question from Willie. He had a some bowls in the house. Noticed they moved over 10 millimetres. Any tips to help prevent this rough happening?
Turning. Absolutely, rough turning. So what we're doing here, this is soaking wet timber. This was collected on Sunday. So what I'm going to do now is rough turn them, as you've seen the ones on the floor, the one I've just done. Leave that 6 to 8 months in this environment. So cool, not too sunny, no massive changes in temperature, and let them settle. They will move. And that's the reason we're doing them so thick. Once they finish moving, like I say, normally in about 6 to 8 months for ash, then you can re-turn them and they should be okay. You still get a bit of movement in timber. It absorbs moisture, it releases moisture. It's a porous material. You also will get, even on dry timber, a little bit of springing. Once you've done the outside of a bowl, you've then taken the inside out, you release an awful lot of tension. So sometimes you will get movement in a bowl as you're making it. Like I say, even on dry timber. So then, our next job will be, and we're not going to remount the bowl. I'll go through the process of setting this up because I just want to show you how to use lots of those templates as well. You see the benefit of having that in the middle to start with. It really does help you out when you're doing your other bowls. Yes, Vic?
Question from Rob. Has Colwyn ever made a three-corner bowl? Is there any extra precautions I will have to make?
No, I haven't. I'll tell you who to look at. Go and look at Jimmy Clues. Brilliant. Fantastic wood turner. I've grown up with Jimmy. He's one of my best turning buddies. Have a look at his videos online. He does, I think he's got some videos out there how to make a three-cornered bowl. He'll talk you through that. Not my strength, I'll be honest, never done one, but Jimmy is the man. Jimmy Clues wood turning. You can find him online, Google him, you'll see videos and things like that. Like I say, great turner.
Another question from James. How many bowls could you core out of a dry 12-inch by 3 bowl blank?
A 12 by 3, probably only get two. Probably get the main one and the other one. It's the thickness is the issue. I'll show you that now. So let's put that back in. Put that where I want it to. Get that nice and close. So what we're looking for is now the template. I'm still using the big blade. So I'm putting this flat section on the back of the bowl, and look, this is the centre of the bolt, that bolt there. So I now need to bring this bolt back to marry up. Lock that back in position. There we are. So that's how far away that bolt needs to be. Because this is just a 3-inch blank now, so I'll get that one. Will I get another one? I don't think I will now. So I'll only get the 3 out of that blank. And that was a big old 14-inch blank, that one. So it's the depth here that is the critical bit. Did you have a question?
No, I think somebody was answering somebody else.
Good on you, everybody.
Somebody said that they love Jimmy Clues too.
Good. What's the time? We're not going to do this one. I'll start it for you. But there we are. Locked in position. Everything's locked. That's coring right over where I need it to be. My bolt is in the right position for my back of the bowl. Vicky's going to walk away again. Vicky was making walking funny away. Facial expressions when I was doing this.
Scared, more like it.
Speed. No one's asked what speed yet, so I'm turning at about 600 revs, but be sensible. You've got a big piece on there and you're unsure. Don't go crazy with speed. Right, I'm putting my ear protectors on again. I'll only get it. We might get to the wall of this one. We'll see. There's the last one.
That's warm.
Thank you, Vic. Take this off. Well, I didn't think we'd get all of that in that time. Vic, can you just pan back? I'm gonna get all the bowls up on the lathe. Side. Where's the other one? That's my money maker. That one there. But otherwise, I would have had those two in a pile of shavings. So I think, for me, the type of turning I do and the type of the amount of timber that I get, this will save money, generate money, not save money. I'll be honest with you, the timber, my if I cleared it, I could have it. So it was a bit of labour for me to get this timber, but now I can gain out of those two bowls. That's my profit, as it were, you know. So there we are, three bowls. I didn't expect to get it done in an hour, and that included rough turning as well. I've got another two big ones to do down there. We've got three or four hollow form pots to do as well. So any more questions, Vic, before I sign off for the day?
No, I don't think so. Just something about cleaning up. Get out quick, Vicky, otherwise hell have you. Yeah, or he'll have you cleaning up as well. No, I'm not cleaning up.
No, unfortunately, I clean up my own workshop.
That was from Dave.
The reason being, Dave, and I've said this before.
Pan down to the shaving.
Pan down. The reason I clean up my own workshop, then I know where everything is.
There we go.
Okay, great. Okay, well, thanks ever so much, guys. Don't forget the daily deal. I sound like I'm on QVC now, but I mean, £100 off. It's ridiculous. And if you're in the position of being able to get this free timber, then I recommend it, definitely. I mean, as well as saving your money, you could do nests of bowls as well. So you could create a trio of bowls to sell. It could be a USP. But guys, thank you very much again for supporting me and Axminster by watching these videos. I'll see you again next week on Tuesday. I've completely forgotten what we're going to be doing. I haven't forgotten what we're going to be doing. It's basic set of tools. We're going to look at the crown set of six tools, and we're going to walk through each one. We're going to look at the skew, the parting tool, the spindle gouger, bowl gouger, scraper, and a roughing gouge. So back to basics. Okay, see you again Tuesday in my workshop. Mrs. Way is waving. thanks very much, guys. See you again on Tuesday. Bye-bye.